Hey everyone, welcome to Simply Learn's YouTube channel. In today's session, we will learn about the array data structure and all the different types of arrays in Java. To help us with the fundamentals of Java, we have Mr. Vikesh with us, an industry professional with years of real-time experience in the field of software development and also has a strong grip on the Java programming language. Now, before we begin, make sure that you have subscribed to our YouTube channel and hit that bell icon to never miss an update from Simply Learn. Now, over to you, Vikesh.
Hello guys, this is Vikesh and let's get started with today's topic, which is about arrays in Java. We discussed about arrays in a bit detail when we talked about the non-primitive data types, but this is a concept and a topic which needs to be understood well. So that's why we'll do a deep dive on arrays in this particular lecture. So as I described earlier, that array is basically a container which can store values or a sequence of values or sequence of numbers or sequence of characters into itself. We can think of it as a box which can store all the values in a continuous fashion. As you can see here, this is just a pictorial representation, and this is coming from the official Java docs. And you can see that if we create an array of size 10, then we have these 10 blocks created here. You can see 1 to 10th. So the whole length of boxes, the number of boxes here are 10. But the way arrays are designed is that the index is basically used to access the element in this particular box. The index of the boxes start from 0. So it goes from 0 to 9. So remember, the array length is 10. The array can contain 10 elements, but the index of the array starts with 0 and will always end at length minus 1, which is 10 minus 1 in this case, which comes as 9. So it will always be length minus 1. It will always the index will always start from 0 and go till length minus 1. Length can be anything. In this case, the length is 10, so the index ends at 9. If the length was 20, the last index will be 19. But in total, you have these 10 memory locations. We also call them as continuous memory locations because they are continuously placed. An array basically blocks 10 memory locations and creates a container over it. So this is how an array basically looks like inside the memory. And whenever you want to access the elements of the array, you will say array of 0 or array of 1 or array of 2. You basically need to specify the index to access the element at index. For example, if you want to access the element which is sitting in this box, you need to say array of index 8. And we'll see how we can do that. But this is the basic understanding and idea of the concept of arrays. So let's try to understand this with the help of an example. I will switch back to Eclipse IDE. And I've created a very simple program here to demonstrate the functionality of arrays here. So we already covered in the previous lecture of what is package and what is public and what is class. How do we give the class name and what is the meaning of this particular method? So I'm not going to cover that again. We'll start directly from here. So here the first thing which I'm doing is I'm declaring an array of integer. This is a variable name, the identifier basically. It can be anything. And this is the data type. It's an integer array. And as we covered this as well, that whenever you put square bracket in front of a data type, it becomes an array data type. So this is an integer array representation. Now, we just declared an array, but we still haven't allocated a size to it. So you can do that with this particular syntax. So you can put the variable name of the array and say new int and put the right size here. This size can be anything. And once you do this, now array will actually allocate those memory boxes which we covered here. But the moment you do new int 10, these continuous boxes will be placed in the memory and the memory is allocated to this array. We call this memory allocation. This is how you allocate memory to the array. So we allocated memory to this array for storing 10 integers. The next thing is now we can start storing elements in those boxes. So like I said, that the array index always starts with 0. So if you have to store the first element, you actually have to store it at index 0 location. So you give the array name, you provide these square brackets, and you put the index value within the square brackets. That is how you basically point to a particular element inside the array. So we say an array of 0 and we put the value 100. Then we initialize the second element, which will be index 1. Then will be the third element, which will be index 2. Fourth element, index 3. Fifth element, index 4. Sixth element, index 5, and so on. And till we store till the last element. So this is the 10th element, which is accessible as index 9. And the value is 1000 basically. So from 100 to 1000, we stored 10 values in this array. And we stored them by accessing the index. And this is actually the only way you can store values in the array, by pointing to the indexes. So we go from 0 to 9 and we stored all the values. 0 being the first element and array of 9 being the last and the 10th element. Remember the length minus 1 concept. Okay, so now we will try to print all the elements one by one. That's pretty much what we are doing now. So as we covered in the previous lecture, that we use system.out.println to print anything, and we understood the whole meaning of this, so I'm not going to repeat that. Now we want to print the first element. The first element is sitting at index 0, and we can access that element with this syntax by providing the variable name and the actual index value. So I'm just writing a random string here which says element at index 0, and then I'm putting this plus here and putting the variable name. This plus is basically used to concatenate the output of a static string with a random variable, or basically you can print anything with using plus. Plus is used for concatenation. So I'm just trying to print this whole value, but here this is a string value which is a static string, and then I have a value coming from the array. So whenever you have to print some value from a particular data type or variable or collection, then you can use this plus syntax to concatenate a string, static string, with your actual value. So that's what I've done here by saying plus and array 0. And similarly for index 1, I'm printing the first index, then for 2, 3, so far, and so on so forth till the index 9. So basically I'm just printing all the values of the array starting from index 0 to index 9. So that's all which is written in this program. Now let's try to run this program. So I will right click, go to run as, and go to Java application and hit on this. And now if I just expand this console, you can see all the system.out.println statements have been executed, and they printed this. So this is the static string part, in fact including the colon. This is the static string part, element and index 0, printing exactly as is. And then dynamically the 0th index element of an array is printed here. Similarly, we have printed the index 1 location element, index 2 location element, index 3 location element, and so on so forth till the index 9 location element. So in total these are the 10 elements, but the index always works from 0 to length minus 1. In this case it will be going from 0 to 9. So this is basically all which I wanted to cover in this lecture. The whole idea was to give you more understanding of arrays. And remember, this is just an integer array. You can similarly create a character array. You can also create a string array for you as well. So it's completely related to the data type you are using. If you create a char array, then you can only store characters into it. If you create a string array, then you can only store strings into it. And now you can probably relate back to this particular thing which I explained in the previous lecture, that we create this string array for the reason that when you run this particular program, and if you want to provide any command line values, command line arguments to the program, those arguments will automatically be stored in this args, and then you can access this as args of 0, args of 1, etc. in your program. That's the whole concept.
Let's get started with understanding arrays in detail. We have been talking about arrays throughout this course of Java in the previous sessions as well, and we have covered some basic understanding of how to create arrays, how to declare them, how to fill values in the array, and how do we print the array with positions as well as the array as whole. But whatever examples which we took previously were one-dimensional arrays, because arrays can have more than one dimensions as well. You can create a one-dimensional array, you can create a two-dimensional array, you can create even a three-dimensional array, and you can go up to as many dimensions as you can handle in your Java program. So it depends upon the kind of complexity you want to have in your program and the kind of values, the kind of structure you are going to store in your arrays.
And based on that need, you can choose whether you want to use a 1D array or one dimensional array or a 2D array or a 3D array and so on. In these sessions, we are going to talk about 1D arrays, 2D arrays, and 3D arrays. And after that, we'll leave up to you to try out more dimensionals if you want to. We have already covered the basic array structures, which were one-dimensional arrays. So I will just give you a quick walkthrough of how we actually handled one-dimensional arrays. So this is a sample program to demonstrate one-dimensional arrays. If you remember, this is how we used to create arrays. We write the data type of the array, and then we write the square boxes, which denote that this is an integer array data type. We assign a variable to this, and then we initialize the array with the size 4. So new is the keyword which is used to initialize anything in Java, and we are going to use this heavily when we talk about classes and objects and even collections. Literally any object which you want to create in Java requires a new keyword. So here I'm writing new and then int 4, which means create an array of size 4. And then I'm filling the value of the 4 positions which I have created as part of this array. And if you remember, when we create these kind of arrays, we store them in a zero index based position. The first value gets stored at 0th index position and then so on and so forth. So it will always start from 0 and never start from 1. Remember that. And after that, we just print all the values of individual positions of the elements in the array. And if I just run this program, all of the elements of this particular array should be printed one by one. So if I just show the full console of the output, we can see that element at index 0 was 10, element at index 1 was 20, element at index 2 was 30, and element at index 3 was 40. So this was just a quick refresher of how one-dimensional arrays can be written. And whenever you declare a very simplistic array, it will generally be a one-dimensional array. Now let's look at the two-dimensional arrays and how do we write them, when do we need them. For that, I have created another example, which is says two-dimensional array. I just created a class, and it has a public static void main method, and I've created a two-dimensional array this time. So let's understand this two-dimensional array in a bit detail. And when do we need that? Generally, you would need to use two-dimensional arrays whenever you are trying to do any matrix calculations. If you understand what do you mean by matrix, it's basically a 2x2 structure which stores the values in the form of rows and columns. So imagine a table of two rows and two columns, then it will be a 2x2 matrix. So if you want to store that particular table in a Java program, you would need to store that as a matrix, as a two-dimensional matrix, rows being the one dimensional and column being the other dimension. And that's what we are doing here. And if you want to store that 2D matrix in a Java program, the approach and the procedure for it is pretty similar to how you create a one-dimensional array with slight changes. The first change is, instead of a single square bracket, you're going to write two square brackets because it is a two-dimensional array. So remember, the number of square brackets you are going to put while initializing and declaring the array is the number of dimensions which your array is going to have. Since this is a two-dimensional array example, that's why you see two brackets here. If this was a three-dimensional array example, you will see three square brackets here, and so on and so forth. So that's the first part of it. Second part to understand is to how to store the data. Remember, I told you always imagine the structure of rows and columns whenever you are trying to store a two-dimensional array in Java. So what are rows and what are values and how do you represent them while you declare and initialize a two-dimensional array? So you start with the curly braces as a normal 1D array, but inside the curly braces, you create nested curly braces blocks. We can see three blocks here. They start with their own curly brace and end with their own. Then this curly brace starts here and ends here. And then this curly brace starts here and ends here. Idea is that you provide this outer curly braces to define the overall structure. And then inside, each of the curly braces is going to represent a row in your two-dimensional array. So each of these values, these blocks, is going to represent a row. So I can say that this is the first row, this is the second row, and this is the third row. And if I try to visualize it in terms of columns, then this is the first row, first column, first row, second column, first row, third column. Similarly, second row, first column, second row, second column, second row, third column, and third row, first column, third row, second column, and third row, third column. So individual values are going to be represented as columns, and the whole curly braces is going to be represented as arrays. That's the basic mental idea or mental image you should have while declaring a two-dimensional arrays. Remember to declare the rows inside the nested curly braces, and whatever elements you have will automatically be indexed as columns. Another thing to remember that since this is an array data structure, everything starts from zero and nothing starts from one. So this will be row zero, this will be row one, and this will be row two. I'm talking about the position. We can still call it as first row, second row, and third row, but the position of this particular row element is zero. The position of this particular row element is one, and this particular row element is two. Similarly for column as well, this is column zero, column one, and column two. Similarly, column zero, column one, and column two, and so on and so forth. Once you understand this data structure well, and you have defined it correctly, then everything should fall in place. If you want to do a matrix addition, or if you want to do a matrix multiplication, or a dot product, all of the kind of calculations can be performed using the 2D array concept. Here in this program, what I'm doing is I am printing the values of this particular 2D array into a matrix style. And you see some strange code here, which is for, etc. Don't worry about this. I'm going to cover in detail what this for means and how do you write this. For now, what we can understand that we just want to print this. You might not need to print this in your Java programs when you write a production grid application, but you might want to do manipulations on these arrays as matrix. Maybe you want to create a transpose of a matrix, or you want to do a dot product or addition or subtraction or whatever be your use case. In this case, just for demonstration purpose, I'm printing the values as rows and columns, nothing else. So this all of this code from line 8 to line 14, or in fact line 13, is just showing how to print the values. You can see some system.out, and you can see some construct here. And like I said, don't worry about this. I will cover this in detail. Let's run this program and see if my Java array is stored correctly and how can I represent this. So you can see I have represented it in a style of a 2D matrix, where this is the first row, this is the second row, and this is the third row. Similarly, this is the first column containing the value 237. So column 0 will have value 2, and column 1 will have this value 3, and column 2 will have this value 7 for row 0. Let me also do something here which can help you understand this concept better. Let me do a system.out.println, and let's print an individual value, because like I said, the for loop can be confusing here to understand. So let's say I want to print ARR of 0th row, first column, and see what kind of values do we get. Let me comment this code. Comment is control backslash, and this code will be commented, and this code will not be executed. And now only line 15 will be executed instead of the for block. So if I run this, I get the value 7. So row 0 and first column. Row 0, first column is 7. Let's try with 1, 1. I want to print the row at zero, 1 position. Remember, not the first row, but the 1 position row, which is basically technically the second row. So second row, second column, and see what kind of value do I get in this case. I get 6. So second row, second column. Similarly, if you change this value to 2, then third row, second column, which should point to 4. Yes, we get 4. Similarly, you can write a value here as 0, and you can write a value here as, let's say, 2. This will print the 0th row and the second column. So similarly, whatever kind of value you want to write, you want to access, you can access it in this fashion. And remember, the column and row indexes will always start from 0. So this is a simple demonstration of how you can use two-dimensional arrays. And in this session, we also did a refresher of one-dimensional array. Let's get started with how to create and use a three-dimensional array, or how to go about using multi-dimensional arrays in Java. So as you can see from this image, we talked about 1D array, which is having just one axis. Then we talked about 2D arrays in the last session, where we had rows and columns, basically an x-axis and a y-axis. And then we can also have a 3D array, which will have three axes, which will have an x-axis, a y-axis, and also a z-axis. Think of a simple box, which every box in this world will always have at least three dimensions. And from here, you can go even build more complex arrays, which can have four dimensions or five dimensions or as many dimensions as you want it to have. And today we are going to look at an example of how can we build a 3D array and how do we access those elements. But this picture is just to show you the mental model of when you will be creating a 3D array. So for example, generally an image data is stored in three dimensions. So you might want to store the image data into a 3D array. And there can be many other use cases in the mathematical and research computational use cases where you might want to use a 3D array. So, but remember, there's an x-axis, there's a y-axis, and then there is a third axis, which is called the z-axis. So let us look at a Java program to understand how we can build a three-dimensional array. And for that, I have created this class, which is called multi-dimensional array. It has a entry point method, which is the public static void main method. And then I have created an integer array. And this time, instead of one or two square brackets, I have three square brackets. And if you remember, I mentioned this in the previous session as well, the number of square brackets which you're going to put while initializing the array is the number of dimensions of the array. And since in this particular program, I'm going to demonstrate a three-dimensional array, that's why you see three square boxes. Let me just minimize this. Yep. So we have three square boxes here, and we have created the variable name as ARR, or short form as array. Then we start with the outermost curly braces as is. Then we put another curly braces, which starts from here and it ends here. Then another set of curly braces, which starts from here and end here. So this is the first dimension. This is the second dimensions. And these are the third dimensions. That's how you're going to define the different dimensions. Remember, this is the first dimension when the first curly brace starts. Then you have the second dimension, which covers this hole and this hole. And then you have third dimension, which are these. So that's how you're going to visualize and put the three dimensions in use while declaring a three-dimensional array. And the values work in the same fashion. It's a zero index-based position. So since we do not have an official name for the third dimension, so I'm just going to use x-axis, y-axis, and z-axis to refer to the three axes. So this would be x of 0, this would be y of 0, and this would be z of 0. Similarly, x of 1, y of 1, and z of 1, and so on and so forth. So now if I try to access the value which is at 0th x position, first y position, and second z position, what's the value do we get here? Let's run this program and understand and interpret the output. Okay, so when we ran this program, we got the output as 11. So let's understand this output. So when we say the 0th position on x, the first position on y, and the second position on z. So this is the 0th position on x, and this is the first position on y, and then this element is 0, 1, 2 is the second position on the z-axis. So to describe it in a nutshell, this defines the x-axis. So we have two elements on the x-axis here, this one and this one. Then we have two elements on the y-axis on each x-axis. So this is one, this is two on the first x-axis, and this is one and this is two on the second second x-axis. So 2x and 2y, and then on the z-axis, I have three elements each. So hope this helps you understand and visualize this. So x-axis, and this one is other x-axis, and then y-axis, and then in elements inside this are z-axis. So I'm saying 0th x-axis in this block, first on the y-axis, which is this block, and then second element or the z or second position element on this particular axis in this particular block, which is 11. And that's why we get 11. If I print 0, let's say I change this particular value as 1. So now the output should be coming from this side. So second x position, because it's 1, second y position, so this will go here, and then the 2 position, which is the third element of the z-axis, which is 13. So let's see if we get 13. Yes, we get 13 here. So this is just to show you how you can interpret this particular array, and always be mindful of how you are structuring this array. If your structure is gone wrong, then your program will become useless and it will give you a lot of unpredictable outputs which might not make sense and which may introduce errors in your program. So be very careful how you define the structure of the elements here. That's the key. And after that, you just need to understand the x-axis, the y-axis, and the z-axis. Always remember all the axes start from 0. So when I say 2, I'm basically referring to the third element and not the second element. So this is all I wanted to cover in this particular session, where we describe how we can use a three-dimensional array. And from here, you can go to any lengths. Like I said, you can add more square brackets here and go to 4-dimension or 5-dimension or 6-dimension. But remember, the more dimensions you add, the more complexity of the program will be having. The program will become more and more difficult to debug and understand. So always try to take a wise call as to how many dimensions you want to use in your array. And that's it for this particular session.
And with that, we have come to an end of this tutorial on arrays in Java. Thank you so much, Vikesh. It was a pleasure having you with us in this wonderful session. If you have any questions about the topics covered in this video or feel we missed out on something, please let us know in the comment section below and our 24/7 experts will be happy to solve all your queries. Thank you for watching, and until next time, stay safe and keep learning.
Hi there, if you like this video, subscribe to the Simply Learn YouTube channel and click here to watch similar videos. To nerd up and get certified, click here.